basically, the level of production for a given firm, little q, will be derived from how firms behave in different market settings. And the market setting we're going to start with today is the classic starting point for economics, which is the market setting of perfect competition. We're going to start talking about perfectly competitive markets, a benchmark of perfect competition. What perfect competition, this is basically a case where many firms are selling goods to many consumers. We're then going to, in the next few lectures, talk about more realistic alternatives like monopoly, which is not a game but rather a market structure, which is basically a case where one firm sells to many consumers, or oligopoly, my favorite word in all of economics, which is when, not because I like the topic so much, I think it's a cool word, which is when several firms sell to a large market, which is probably the most realistic setting of all. And we're going to come to talk about those. But today we're going to start with our benchmark of perfect competition. Now, what is perfect competition? Okay. Basically, I can give you a technical definition. Technically, perfect competition exists whenever firms are price takers on both the output and inputs markets. They're price takers on both the output and input markets. So perfectly competitive firms are price takers. That is, no action that they take can affect either the price at which they sell their goods or the price that they pay for their inputs. No action, they're price takers, they're not price makers. No action they take affects either the price at which they sell their goods, no action the individual firm takes affects either the price at which they sell their goods or the price they pay for their inputs. Okay. Well, when will this be true? Well, we think about, go back to lecture one. Technically, this would be true if a firm faced perfectly elastic demand for their goods. If you face perfectly elastic demand for goods, and if they had perfectly elastic supply of inputs. Under those conditions, firms will be perfectly competitive if they face perfectly elastic demand for their goods and perfectly elastic supply of inputs. Okay? So let's focus on the first of those, okay? Which is perfectly elastic demand. Let's take a look at figure 10.1. Okay? These should be little q's, by the way. This isn't a market, this is a firm. These should be little q's. So basically, what you have here is that you have a firm facing a perfectly elastic demand. What that means is the firm's quantity is pegged by their supply curve. Or in other words, the point is the firm cannot change the price one iota from that level P. Okay? So in other words, if there's supply shift, if say the first price of the firm's inputs go up, the firm doesn't get to charge any more for their goods. They just sell fewer goods. Okay? So the supply shift from S1 to S2, the firm's going to move from this should be little q1 to little q2. They're going to reduce the quantity they sell, but they cannot change the price because they've faced perfectly elastic demand. Okay? So when does this make sense as a description of the world? Well, it makes sense as a description of the world under four conditions. Okay, so there's four conditions under which perfect competition will exist. Four conditions. The first condition is identical products. A firm will be in a perfectly competitive market when the firms in that market sell identical products. Now, let's be clear, they don't have to literally be identical. They have to be perceived by consumers as identical. So when I say identical products, they don't have to literally be identical, but consumers have to consider them identical for purposes of their demand across firms. So firms have to sell identical products for there to be perfect competition. Because if products aren't identical, then firms will be able to charge different prices from each other because they have something different to sell. Okay? So firms need to be identical. Second of all, consumers have to have full information on all prices. That is perfect competition. Well, let me write down the next two conditions because they're related. And the third is low transaction or shopping costs. Okay, these two are critical because the way perfect competition is going to work is consumers are going to shop across firms selling identical goods, and they're going to buy from the cheapest one. Okay? And if there's any failure of either of these, then consumers might not know if you're the cheapest, and therefore you might be able to charge extra. So perfectly elastic demand, okay? Once again, we get into the micro foundations of something we discussed in the second lecture. We discussed for elastic demand. Now we're talking about where that comes from. What conditions do you need? Perfectly elastic demand is going to require that consumers know all the prices and can cautiously shop across all the options. Okay? Otherwise, firms might have some opportunity to charge different prices. Okay? And finally, and we'll come back to why this is important, there needs to be free entry and exit of firms. This one I can't really give you intuition for yet. Just take my word for it. We'll come back to why that's important. Okay? We'll come back to why it's important. Now, in reality, no perfectly competitive market exists. Okay? There's never been a perfectly competitive market.